So this is now a genetic association study, another field of applications where another mathematical theory is involved. So this is a series of talks with nice applications and nice theory at the same time.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Volodya, for the introduction. In this talk, I want to propose Bayesian methodology for evaluating contingency tables in genetic association studies. The talk consists roughly here of five parts. First, I will give an introduction from the biological perspective that leads then to the statistical model that we are considered with. Then I want to propose a Bayesian methodology for data analysis in that context, because the Bayesian approach here is especially nice because it explores the parameter space and not the sample space. And what we will see is that the sample space gets bigger and bigger if we collect more data, while the parameter space stays constant. And this is why the Bayesian methodology is especially convenient. Then in the fourth part, I will show some empirical results which compare this Bayesian approach with previous frequentist approaches, and we will see that the results are rather similar, but the Bayesian methodology is more convenient and also less computational demanding in that circumstance. And then in the fifth part, I will make a transition to the forthcoming talk by Jens Stange, who will talk about effective numbers of tests more deeply, but I will sketch the general idea already. Okay, first, the motivation and the explanation from the biological perspective. So I don't know how much you know about the structure of the human DNA. I sketched a picture here. So we have these two strands of the DNA here to the left and to the right, which form this double helix. And then at specific positions, which are also referred to as loci, there we have bases, which can be adenine, cytosine, guanine, or thymine, so A, C, G, or T for short, and they encode our genetic information. And you see this is always complementary information because A always binds with T and G always binds with C. So if you know one side, one strand, then you already know what the other strand is. And these possible bases that can appear at certain loci, they are referred to as alleles. So here, at this particular position, for example, you would have the allele A on this strip. And since body cells in humans are diploid, we get genetic information by our mother and by our father, you have to think about this whole picture doubled, yeah, in our body cells. And then, of course, even if you consider only one strand, because the other one is complementary, but you get information from your mother and your father, you have pairs of alleles that you can observe at every locus. And then if you have the same allele from your mom and from your dad, then you are called homozygous at this position J, and otherwise this is called heterozygous. And then the statistical problem that we will be considered with is to find loci which are in association with certain phenotypes. For example, with a disease, if some allele combination at some locus makes an increased type 2 diabetes risk and so on and so forth. To describe the data situation a little bit more concretely, we assume that we have genetic variability only in terms of biallelic SNPs. That means that at every genetic locus, exactly two of the four possible alleles are actually observable. So you can either have one specific allele, let's call it A1, or you can have the other one, which is denoted by A2. And if you then think about one strand of DNA just rolled out, so that it is just a linear sequence, then you see you have these loci here ranging from 1 up to M, let's say. And if you have one study participant, for example Tom, then you can just write down which alleles he has at all these different loci. And I have marked some of these loci, namely the loci 4, J, and M, with color, because I assume that at these loci there is genetic variability. So large parts of the DNA, there is no genetic variability, because otherwise important body functions would be impaired, but at some loci there is variability, and these positions I marked here in color. And then if you have not only Tom, but for example Andrew and Rachel, then you see here that Tom, for example, has the T here, and Andrew and Rachel has the C. And since these are biallelic SNPs, single nucleotide polymorphisms, that means no other letter apart from T or C is possible here at this position 4. And here you have position J, there Tom and Andrew have A, but Rachel has G, and so on and so forth. But then, as I said, diploid body cells, you do not only have information on one chromosome, but you have the maternal genetic information and the paternal genetic information, and then you have these pairs of letters that you can observe at every genetic position. So if you do that, then you see here at position 4, Tom and Andrew are homozygous, while Rachel is heterozygous, and here, for example, the heterozygous person is Andrew, and so on and so forth. Yeah? And then the question is there, if you have a larger sample size than just three, is there a systematic relationship between these pairs of letters and some phenotype of interest, for example, some disease? This is the setup. And to model that statistically, we can summarize the information that we have in a sample of size capital N at one particular locus J in such a contingency table. So you have N study participants all together. In our simple example, N would be 3. And then you just count how many of the people with phenotype 1, so maybe diabetic people, have this allele combination, this allele combination, and you have the observed counts here, these X's. And the same you can do for the non-diseased individuals, and then this forms a contingency table at every genetic locus. And especially in case control studies, you fix numbers N1 of cases and N2 of controls beforehand. So you decide that you sample, for example, 100 cases and 200 controls, and then these numbers N1 and N2, they are fixed by experimental design, while these column margins here, they are also random. So everything is random except from N1, N2, and N. Yeah, this is the setup, case control study. This is often done because if you would have a prospective study, then you would have to wait much longer until the event of interest occurs, so that case control studies are favored in practice. Okay, and then the association test problem, as I described it already verbally, if you want to formalize this mathematically, then you see that you have multiple test problems, that you have to do M statistical tests simultaneously based on the same data, where every hypothesis J corresponds to one genetic locus, and the null hypothesis says that the genotype at this locus is stochastically independent of the phenotype that you are interested in. And the phenotype, of course, does not depend on the locus, because this is something like diseased, yes or no. And then you have to solve all these statistical test problems in parallel, simultaneously, based on the same data. That is the problem that you are considering. So what you actually observe is a tensor. So you have such a contingency table here, a two-dimensional object for every J, and then you have J ranging from 1 to N. And the other particular challenge is that all these loci, the data of all these loci, they are correlated with each other because of the biological mechanism of inheritance. So this is the problem. And if I'm only talking about one specific locus, I drop the index J everywhere, because then it does not look so nasty anymore. And then you have here the vector of margins of the contingency table at the position J, which consists of these five numbers here. And X is the contingency table of the observed frequencies of these combinations. And then it's clear under the null hypothesis, this just has here such a hypergeometric distribution, and the conditional probability of observing x given all the marginals is given here by that form.
And null hypothesis, no effect.
Null hypothesis is that the genotype at locus J is stochastically independent of the phenotype.
No effect.
Right? Yeah, no effect. That there is no association between the two quantities. And what the frequentist, the classical approach to such a test problem is the following. You denote the domain of X, so the random variate that describes the contingency table by X. And then the problem is, how can you order this sample space, because it is higher dimensional, and then you find a test statistic that compresses your information into one real number, and if you assume that t tends to smaller values under the alternative, the p-value based on this test statistic conditional to the marginals is just given by the probability under the null hypothesis to observe something at least as severe as what you actually observed. So that is at least as much evidence in favor of the alternative than your actually observed data. And since this is a discrete problem, you can just sum up these elementary probabilities here, and this is the frequentist problem. This is what many people do, but what I want to argue here is that this strategy has two major drawbacks. The first drawback is that the number of tables with matching marginals that has to be visited here in order to collect all these probabilities drastically grows with the sample size. So this can be computed explicitly, how many tables you have to traverse, and this number of tables increases drastically with the total sample size. So that means the more data you have, the worse. And this is an uncomfortable situation for a statistician. For me, it is better, the more data I have, the better, yeah, and not the worse. But in terms of computational complexity, it becomes worse and worse. And what people then do is they say, okay, if n is 1,000 or 5,000 or something like that, I replace the exact distribution by an unconditional asymptotic null distribution, for example, a chi-square. But since we have so many genetic loci which have variability on our genome, sometimes m, the number of comparisons, is 500,000 or 1 million, and you have to correct for the multiplicity in the significance level, you need the null distribution in the extreme tails of the distribution. And there, the chi-squared distribution or the chi-square approximation is inaccurate. Yeah, so this means that there is a dilemma here. The more data you gather, the more difficult it is to evaluate this formula. And on the other hand, asymptotics not work so well in the extreme tails where I have to find the critical value for the test. And what I want to argue is that if one chooses a Bayesian approach to this association test problem, all these drawbacks can be avoided. Okay, the Bayesian methodology that I want to propose here goes as follows. Assume that you have a discretely distributed random vector, t components here, where the sum of all these mt have to sum up to a fixed number n, which would be the number of individuals in the study in our context, and the numbers here are all non-negative. And in addition, we assume a Dirichlet distributed random vector, which was already nicely described in the talk by Konstantin with these nice pictures. This is the Dirichlet distribution that one considers here for this vector of cell probabilities. And then the model assumption is that given the vector of cell probabilities, the random vector X is multinomially distributed with T categories, total sample size N, and this vector P of cell probabilities. And the reason why this Dirichlet distribution is often chosen in this context is conjugacy. That is what was already mentioned. So if you assume a Dirichlet prior for P, then the posterior distribution, if you assume a multinomial likelihood, is again Dirichlet, where only the parameters have to be updated. And to simplify the model a little bit more, we assume that all these parameters here, they are all equal and equal to A, then one can just integrate the Dirichlet distribution out, and the unconditional point mass function of the random vector X is given by this formula too. So this is then the unconditional point mass function of X. And this distribution here is called the symmetric Dirichlet multinomial distribution. Some people call it also the Polya distribution, and it has three parameters: number of categories, total sample size, and this so-called flattening parameter A. So this is a reasonable model motivated by conjugacy, but the problem is how to choose A. If I choose a specific A, then I have very subjective information put into the model, so it is reasonable to assume a hyper prior, so a prior for this parameter A, which enables one to do objective Bayesian analysis. And this hyper prior for the parameter A should have mass almost everywhere, yeah, because otherwise it would not be uninformative. And leads to the following object here, the function capital Phi, which is the most important object here in the whole talk, where one considers a mixture of these symmetric Dirichlet multinomial distributions, where the parameter A is mixed according to a uninformative prior distribution. And this person here, Good, 1976, argued that log Cauchy is a good hyperprior because it has mass almost everywhere. Yeah? So the A must be positive, so it must be a distribution on the positive real half line, and log Cauchy has extremely heavy tails, so it has mass almost everywhere. And in this paper, this was proposed, it was argued that this is particularly suitable for objective Bayesian contingency tail analysis. And if you buy that, then I denote this symmetric Dirichlet mixture prior for the hyper parameter of the hyper prior for the parameter by D star, which depends on the number of categories T and on an additional scaling parameter T prime, which will become obvious in a minute. Okay, and now back to the data analysis. So we assume under the null hypothesis, there you don't know the marginal probabilities for the column counts. There we assume this Dirichlet mixture prior for these probabilities for the column counts, such that this phi function evaluated at these arguments here is the prior probability of the observed column counts. And under the null hypothesis, this already completely specifies the data generating process, because under the null hypothesis, the columns and the rows are stochastically independent, and the row sums are fixed by experimental design, so the probability of observing X given the number of cases and the number of controls under the null hypothesis can be very simply expressed like that. And under the alternative, of course, all these cell probabilities, all the six cell probabilities are unknown, so I have to assume a prior for all these six parameters, and there again I choose this Dirichlet mixture prior now with six categories. Yeah, and then you have that the probability of observing X under the alternative, given the row counts, which are fixed by our experimental design, is given by this expression here. And there you see what this parameter T prime that I talked about before, where this plays a role, because if you assume a prior for all the six cell probabilities or for all the six cell counts, then this automatically implies a prior for the column counts, because the column counts are just the sums of the cell entries, and this is where this T prime comes into play. So here you have this probability of observing the actual table under the null hypothesis and the probability of observing the table under the alternative. And what the Bayesian approach to hypothesis testing then is just to build the ratio of these two expressions, which is called the Bayes factor. Yeah, the Bayes factor is just the ratio of observing the data under the null hypothesis over the probability of observing the data under the alternative. And what you see here is that all these numbers are obtained by scalar operations. So the only thing that you have to do is to compute four numbers and multiply them with each other. This is all that has to be done in order to summarize the information from a Bayesian viewpoint. So if you want to summarize the evidence against the null hypothesis from a Bayesian viewpoint, you only have to calculate four numbers and multiply them with each other. While you have to compute this p-value, which is computationally demanding if you want to do the same summarization of the information from a frequentist viewpoint. The subscript 2 here indicates that the column counts are random. Yeah? So Bayes factor, where the second dimension of the table consists of random numbers. So far so good. The question is how compatible are these two approaches? Do they lead to similar conclusions or to totally different conclusions? And in order to address this question, I analyzed a data set, or I reanalyzed the data set that I was already considering before. It is data generated by the Wellcome Trust Case Control Consortium in the United Kingdom. It's a very big study with several thousands of study participants, and here I focus on one particular disease that was analyzed, Crohn's disease, and originally this data set comprised approximately 500,000 SNPs. So that means M, the number of tests that have to be performed simultaneously, is 500,000. But since this is a little bit too much, I pre-screened the data, so I came up with a list of interesting candidate loci by applying a screening criterion here, the false discovery rate criterion, to the full data set, and after that step, roughly 2,000 candidate loci remained. And what I want to present here is now the computation of the Bayes factor that I just introduced for these 1,800 candidate loci and compare them with the frequentist p-values, which need much, much longer time to compute. And the result is as follows. I produced this table here. The table lists the 34 smallest Bayes factors in increasing order. So that means the smaller the Bayes factor, the more evidence against the null hypothesis, so the more evidence in favor of association you have. And here you see the smallest Bayes factor, and here you see the 34th smallest Bayes factor. Here is information in the first column about the chromosome, where the genetic position is located, and the name of the genetic position. They all have unique identifiers, so-called RS numbers, and here you see the 34 smallest Bayes factors in increasing order. And in this previous publication that I mentioned, we found with the frequentist method, the p-value-based method, 24 significances according to the family-wise error rate criterion, and you see here the first 20, so the top 20 Bayes factors only comprise positions which are also claimed significant from the frequentist point of view, and then here in the positions 21 up to 34 you find three additional from these 24 significances, so only one of the frequentist significance is not among the top 34 Bayes factors. And I checked back with the original data, and actually the 24 significance was an artifact, so this publication is wrong. Yeah. So this 24 significance was an artifact, and when I reanalyzed the data, I saw that only 23 real significances are in the data, and the top 34 Bayes factors comprise all these 23 real significances. So the computational time and cost is drastically reduced, and the answer is more or less the same. Okay, this more or less completes my talk. I want to make one final remark on effective numbers of tests, because if you do not only want to tabulate the Bayes factors from small to large, but if you really want to make a decision to claim a significance from a Bayesian point of view, you have to define a loss function, and you have to optimize your risk. So this is Bayesian decision theoretic multiple comparison procedures, but in order to do that, you have to complete the probability model also by specifying prior probabilities for the null hypothesis, because the decision theoretic procedures, they threshold posterior probabilities, and posterior probabilities are functions of Bayes factors and prior probabilities. So you need also prior probabilities for all these null hypotheses, and especially if M is large, you are often not in the situation that you can specify individual prior probabilities for every J, but you choose the same prior probability pi naught for each H J. So that is roughly the amount of signal in the data that you expect. And then the problem, of course, is multiplicity correction. So if you would only have one hypothesis to test, then you would compute the Bayes factor, weight it with the prior probability, then you get the posterior probability, and you threshold that. But here you have the problem that you have to do m comparisons simultaneously. So the problem of multiplicity correction arises. And one early approach to that problem was here by David in 1987, who proposed to take pi naught as big pi naught to the power of 1 over m, where big pi naught is the probability for the global hypothesis. So the global hypothesis means there is no information about the disease in the genetic data at all. So all positions are uninformative. So if you want to express that mathematically, that is the intersection of all these HJ. And then you get this number, probability for the global hypothesis, by the researcher, and you choose pi naught equal to this expression here. But this is only good or reasonable if all positions would be independent of each other because of the multiplicative structure here of this formula. But actually what we have in the genetic data are strong correlations which can technically be described by so-called linkage disequilibrium matrices, which will be the topic of the final talk for today. And our proposal is that one replaces the full dimensionality m in this exponent here by the effective number of tests m effective here, which is smaller than m, and this gives higher power for detecting true associations, because it takes the dependencies, at least the bivariate or the trivariate dependencies, explicitly into account. And this is what my colleague Jens Stange will be talking about in a minute. This concludes my talk. I provide you with the references that I used during the presentation, and if you want to learn more, you can also look in chapter 9 of this book. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, thanks, Thorsten.
One point that's often questioned in genetic studies is the reproducibility of the experiment. Is this something which needs to be taken into account? Or?
This is a very good question, because as you know, I applied for a grant at the German-Israeli Foundation, and the title of the proposal is Replicability in Genetic Association Studies. So hopefully at the next meeting I can give you some answers.
The question is about could you explain more why we use a mixture of
So that the Dirichlet distribution plays a role at all is due to conjugacy. So this is what makes it natural. It's more or less compatible with each other. Multinomial likelihood and Dirichlet prior is compatible with each other. But if you choose a fixed parameter A, then this is subjective, because you chose that A, and the data analysis in the end depends on what A did you choose.
Yeah. But if I choose
the
2 or 3 parameters,
it's... Yeah, and I propose to choose infinitely many of them by assigning a hyperprior to A.
But you could also try to take different values A along some scale and then take...
I think what he proposes would be like a discrete distribution, where you have like 3 possible values of A and you give them some prior probabilities, but... What this paper proposed, and I think it's reasonable to use a prior which has mass on the whole positive half line and mass almost everywhere.
Wenn Sie sagen, So there was some theory behind this approach, which tells that you can use empirical base, which is almost equivalent to, which is not so posterior.
Yeah, and this is a very good comment, because this is a proxy for Jeffrey's prior. But Jeffrey's prior would be improper here. You could not calculate the posterior probability. So this is a good proxy for Jeffrey's prior.
But if you, for example, different patterns correspond to hypotheses, so you need to check. Can we use Dirichlet prior mixture, and each component in this mixture will correspond to one of the hypotheses?
I agree. Often you have more specific prior information. For example, the expected allele frequencies at specific loci, they are also tabulated somewhere in the internet. So you could choose you could use that information. Yeah. So you may argue about the hyper prior, but I think this discussion does not lead too far.
Yeah. Comment a little bit about this way, Bayesian approach to multiple testing. So somehow you compute this Bayesian factor, which means so you have two different priors under the null and the alternative, and then you compare the posteriors at the same point. But could you somehow justify this? I mean, it's nice that you have the same empirical results at the end of the day, but what could
be? What I would do in order to complete the probability model, I would specify the prior probability of the null hypothesis, and then I would have a risk function, so a loss function and a risk for every position, Rj. Which depends on some parameters, so cost parameters and stuff like that. And then the total risk, so R, would be the sum of the Rj. And then, since I have a completely described probability model, I can just come up with an optimal strategy in order to make my risk smallest. And this means, for reasonable risk functionals, this is just thresholding of posterior probability. So if I can transform the Bayes factor by means of the prior probability into a posterior probability, I can just threshold at that, and this depends. The threshold that one uses depends on the particular choice of the risk functions. But it is fully specified, because you have the complete probability model. Then there is nothing to do anymore.
Somehow my general feeling is so there is no free lunch by using Bayesian approach. I mean, earlier or later you have the same phenomena within the Bayesian approach as you have in the frequentist one.
Yeah.
And if you also somehow motivate in the frequentist approach, you run into the extreme tails because of multiplicity correction.
Yeah.
And I can't imagine that you can completely avoid this by using the Bayesian calculus. So this is a little bit mystery for me. So I mean, because this problem is still there about multiplicity correction, and then you
the multiplicity correction is there, yeah.
Yeah, this means you again have to run into some extreme.
And the multiplicity correction is here in the construction of the prior. Because you see the prior probability for each individual null hypothesis to be true depends on how many hypotheses you test. So this is the multiplicity correction. It enters the prior.
But then would lead to some calculus in the extreme tails of multinomial.
But this you can calculate explicitly.
So this is all the advantage that you are working with some conjugated prior explicit distributions. So I mean, you know this extreme field.
Yeah.
So this is what you need.
This is what I need.
Okay. I don't see any further questions, so I suggest we send Thompson next week.